Jaden.
My name is Eli.
My name is Jason.
My name is Caden.
And we are the Ahua and the Torah YouTube channel.
And we know your time is very important, so we'll make this as quick and simple and understandable as possible.
And here we are. Another day of reading the Torah. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. We do appreciate, again, your precious time. That is one thing in the world that we can never, ever recover is time. And that is always what I'm encouraging these boys not to waste, is their precious time. And we only have a limited amount of time before, I believe, the forces of darkness overtake us, or our Messiah is able to come back and deliver us from this. But I don't know if it's only me that has noticed that Cobra Commander has taken over the world. And if you hear that in the background, that's thunder. And so hopefully we don't have any rain, because if the rain comes on our little tin roof, there's no way you're going to be able to hear us.
The video will be cut short.
The video will be cut short. So... Much love to everybody out there. And so let's go over real quickly what we did yesterday. Because we found two more commands that were in Genesis 35, but they were repeats of the previous. So if you guys look under Commandment 1 and Commandment 2, Be Fruitful has Genesis 35:11. The second part here, and Elohim said unto him, I am El Shaddai, be fruitful and multiply, a nation and a company of nations shall be... Sorry, folks. Shall be of you, and kings shall come out of your loins. All right, so let me do this. And there was Fearmonger. Hello, Fearmonger. Okay, and so here is the other one, which it is the same. And so instead of us adding multiple commands, it is all the same command. So, I mean, we could go down here and add it as 15 and 16, like the our friends the Jews do. But they're just adding to it. So it's all the same stuff. So let's begin. And we are on Genesis...
36.
And everyone's doing all right out there?
Yep.
Our virtual family, you guys are all doing well, I hope. And pray. Okay, Genesis 36. Now these are the generations of Esau, who is Edom. Esau took his woman of the daughters of Canaan. Adah, the daughter of Elon, the Kitty, and Oholi... Vama, the daughter of Anah, the daughter of Zivon of Zivon the Kivri. These are hard words to say. If you don't believe me, try it. And Basmath, Yishmael's daughter, sister of Nevioth, and Adah bore to Esau Eliphaz, and Basmath bore Reuel. And Oholi Vama bore Ye-Ish and Ye-Ya-Alam and Korak. These are the sons of Esau, which were born unto him in the land of Canaan. And Esau took his women, and his sons, and his daughters, and all the persons of his house, and his cattle, and all his beasts, and all his substance, which he had got in the land of Canaan, and went into the country from the face of his brother Yaakov. For their riches were more than that they might dwell together, and the land wherein they were strangers could not bear them because of their cattle. Thus dwelt Esau in Mount Seir. Esau is Edom. And these are the generations of Esau, the father of the Edom, in Mount Seir. These are the names of Esau's son: Eliphaz, the son of Adah, the woman of Esau; Reuel, the son of Basmath, the woman of Esau. And the sons of Eliphaz were Temon, Omar, Zepho, Gatam, and Kenaz. And Timnah was concubine to Eliphaz, Esau's son, and she bore Eliphaz Amalek. These were the sons of Adah, Esau's woman. And these are the sons of Reuel, Nakath, and Zerach, Shamma, and Mizah. These were the sons of Basmath, Esau's woman. And these were the sons of Oholi Vama, the daughter of Anah, the daughter of Zivon, Esau's woman. And she bore to Esau Ye-Ish, and Ya-Alam, and Korak. These were the dukes of the sons of Esau, the sons of Eliphaz, the firstborn son of Esau, Duke Taman, Duke Omar, Duke Zepho, Duke Kenaz. Okay, these are all going to be the dukes, and we're going to run through the dukes, but why is the lineage, why is all of this important?
It's a history thing. Like, if you want to, you don't believe it, you have like an entire family tree that you can run down. You can look back in history and say, well, this person had this person, this makes sense here. That's why everything looks like correct.
Right. You should be able to technically trace your lineage back to this if you can get far enough back.
Not Esau specifically, but like in the lineages when you see the lineages.
Right. And so this goes through everything so we know who is who and where they all came from. All right. So hang with me as we run through the dukes. Duke Korok, Duke Gatam, and Duke Amalek, these are the dukes that came of Eliphaz in the land of Edom. These were the sons of Adah. And these are the sons of Reu, Esau's son, Duke Nakath, Duke Zerach, Duke Shammah, Duke Mizah. These are the dukes that came of Raul in the land of Edom. These are the sons of Basmath, Esau's woman. Now, why are these guys called dukes?
That's what I was about to say. In my Bible, it says chiefs.
Chiefs. All right, so we have chiefs. Chiefs and dukes. What? Why are they
called? I feel like a duke is like a royal thing, and a chief is more like a tribal thing.
Well, chief was the leader of an Indian tribe, and I mean, a chief would be the leader of this stuff. So, I mean, I think it's essentially these were the leaders of these various areas, and they became the, I guess, dukes of the area. And I don't have much more than that. I'm sure the folks like Brother Todd Bennett and Brother Stephen Pigeon would know exactly what these are. But I believe that they are just basically leaders of these different areas, and they became the dukes of the area. All right, these are the sons of Esau, who is Edom, and these are their dukes. This is 20, right?
Mm-hmm.
Am I right?
Mm-hmm.
These are the sons of Seir, the Kori, who inhabited the land, Lotan, Shoval, and Zivon, and Anah. And Dishon, and Etzer, and Dishon, these are the dukes of the Koriim, the children of Seir in the land of Edom. Now, these are all, at the end, I mean, these people all end up getting killed. These are all very bad people. 22. And the children of Lotan were Kori and Hemin, and Lotan's sister was Timnah. And the children of Shoval were Alion and Manakath, and Elival, Shepia, and Omen. I'm sure I'm slaughtering these. And these are the children of Zivion, both Aya and Anah. This was that Anah that found the mules in the wilderness as he fed the asses of Zivon, his father. And the children of Anah were these, Dishon and Oholivama, the daughter of Anah. These are the children of Dishon, Himdan, and Eshban, and Yithran, and Keran. Cheran, I believe is how you say that. The children of Etzer are these, Bilhan, and Za'avan, and Akan. The children of Dishon are these, Utz and Aron. And guys, sometimes this reading is very dry. Sometimes this stuff doesn't seem like it leads to anything. But rest assured, it always does lead to something. And, you know, they're setting up for a long journey that we're about to see these folks undertake. So verse 30. Duke Dishon, Duke Etzer, Duke Dishon. This looks like the same thing. No, Dishon was the first one. Dishan was the second. These are the dukes that came of Chori among their dukes in the land of Seir. I think I'm saying that right. Let me see this. Yeah, so it's Chori. Chori, it's a cave dweller. And these are the kings that reigned in the land of Edom before there reigned any king over the children of Yashariel. And Bela, the son of Beor, reigned in Edom, and the name of his city was Dinhabah. And Bela died, and Yovav, the son of Zerach of Bozrah, reigned in his stead. And Yovav died, and Chushom, I think I'm saying that right. It's Chushon. Chushom. It wasn't even close. Chushom of the land of Temani reigned in his stead. And Chushom died, and Hadad, the son of Bedad, who smote Midian in the field of Moab, reigned in his stead. And the name of his city was Aveah. And Hadad died, and Samla of Maskreka reigned in his stead. And Samla died, and Shaul of Rekoboth by the river reigned in his stead. And Shaul died, and Baal, Chan-Kan, and how do I say this again? Ka-Nan. Ka-Nan, the son of Akbor, reigned in his stead. And Baal, Ka-Nan, the son of Akbor, died, and Hadar reigned in his stead. And the name of his city was Pa-U. What does it say in the Holy Scriptures?
Pa-U. P-A-U.
P-A-U, that's what it says here. And his woman's name was how do you say this? Mehetivel?
Mehetivel.
Mehetivel, yeah, Mehetivel. Mehetivel, the daughter of Metred, the daughter of Mezaav. And these are the names of the dukes that came of Esau, according to their families, after their places by their names, Duke Timnah, Duke Aliah, Duke Yetheth, Duke Oholivama, Duke Elah, Duke Pinyon, Pinyon, I think I missed that. That's Pinun. Pinun is how you say that. It actually says Pinun. Duke Kenez, Duke Taman, Duke Mivstar, Duke Magdiel, Duke Ivram. These be the dukes of Edom, according to their habitations in the land of their possession. He is Esau, the father of the Edom. Edom. And that's Edomim.
Ours just says the Edomites.
Edomites, right. And so, any commands? Anyone?
No. There was on there. That was just going through a generation.
Family tree.
Extremely dry reading. Okay, so we made it. Let's go in 37. And Yaakov dwelt in the land wherein his father was a stranger, in the land of Canaan. These are the generations of Yaakov. Yosef, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren, and the lad with the sons of Bilhah, and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's woman. And Yosef brought unto his father their evil report. Now Yashrael loved Yosef more than all his children, because he was the son of his old age, and he made him a coat of many colors. And when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him, and could not speak peaceably unto him. And Yosef dreamed a dream, and he told it his brethren, and they hated him yet the more. Okay, verse 6. I'm going to move it right here so I don't miss this. Okay, so as a parent, I think we should lose a parent card again. Yosef is like the smallest, youngest, one of the youngest, second to youngest of all of these marauders. These guys aren't just like hardcore dudes. These guys are killing machines. They are literally man killers. They are beast killers. They're a different breed of people. And so we have their dad and. Go ahead, tell the story of this. How did this, Jade, when Yashrael, and who is Yashrael, everyone?
Jacob, Yaakov.
Okay, and his name was changed. And so when he was, he was around these people enough, and he ended up giving this kid, if I gave you guys like something, one of you outside of the other one, it would seem a little awkward, right?
It would depend on what happened. Like, if it was
what it was, but I feel like this was like, this kid was getting more attention, more love, more like everything, and there comes a point where you have 12 kids and you can't really choose one out of 12, or meaning that one's going to end up, well,
beat up. Out. Well, and that's the thing, and so everybody knew who he loved, right? And
He made it obvious, not only that, but he like made it obvious. You shouldn't, in the first place, love your kid more, and you shouldn't sit there and like.
Well,
like,
what about loving the wife more? I mean, this came from one.
Yeah, I'm sure they're already upset because their mom wasn't as loved. And so
yeah, that was probably wild to grow up with.
Yeah, well, I mean, the babies were
still Laban's fault.
Yosef and Benjamin were the sons of the wife he loved.
Right.
And so
the two kids he loves the most.
Yeah, he loves the most, and so that would probably be obvious, which is not a good thing for the weakest, which Yosef was.
Honestly, the hate still stems back to when Laban ripped Jacob off and gave him Leah as well. Before he did with Rachel.
There's some family issues. There's definitely some family issues. So I guess that's good news for all of us with family issues, is they could have some tremendous family issues.
The chosen people were messed up.
Yeah, they absolutely were. Yeah, no, there is... there's
some crazy stuff happens.
Yeah, they need priests for sure. Verse 6. And he said unto them, hear, I pray you, this dream which I have dreamed. So here he is, and he's just ticking these people off. He's just making them very angry. Go ahead.
So I'm thinking his brothers had to be at least 70 years old at this point. Or 40. Close right. to 40s. 30s and 40. The older ones are 40.
How old is he? 14?
17.
17.
So he's almost 20. So I'm thinking they about 20 years.
20 here or 17 here?
He's 17. So he's almost 20.
Okay, right. Okay, so he's 17 here. And his brothers are all 40-ish?
I think the older ones are 40. Maybe probably 25 to 40-ish.
It has to be. So there's a huge span on this. And so we have the guy that you absolutely hate, who ends up getting all the good stuff from Pops. And now he's about to say this. For behold, and this is a dream he had, we were binding sheaves in the field, and lo, my sheaf arose and also stood upright. And behold, your sheaves stood around about and made obeisance to my sheaf. So their sheaves bowed down to his sheaf. And his brethren said to him, shall you indeed reign over us, or shall you indeed have dominion over us? And they hated him yet the more for his dreams and for his words. And he dreamed yet another dream and told it his brethren, and said, behold, I have dreamed a dream more, and behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made obeisance to me. So now we have the his basic brothers, as in like stars, bowing down to him, 11 stars. And so these guys are like, yeah, right. Verse 10, and he told it to his father and to his brethren, and his father rebuked him and said unto him, what is this dream that you have dreamed? Shall I and your mother and your brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to you, to the earth?
Even his dad at this point is like, hey, man, stop, please.
Well, yeah, he's
trying to save face.
Creating a family feud. He's the youngest, second to the youngest, is going crazy. And his brethren envied him, but his father observed the same. And his brethren went to flee their flocks in Shechem. And Yashrael said unto El Yosef, do not your brethren feed the flock in Shechem? Come, and I will send you unto them. And he said unto him, here I am. And he said unto him, go, I pray you, see whether it be well with your brethren and well with our flocks, and bring me word again. So he sent him out of the valley of Kivron, and he came to Shechem. And a certain man found him, and behold, he was wandering in the field, and the man asked him, saying, what do you seek? And he said, I seek my brethren. Tell me, I pray you, where they feed their flocks. And the man said, they are departed hence, for I heard them say, let us go to Dothan. And Yosef went after his brethren and found them in Dothan.
So this trip from Shechem to there was like several days' walk. This was not like a quick 30-second walk out to the field where you go in your backyard. This was a several-day walk.
And I believe this guy was an angel, if I remember right. Do you guys remember this one, the story?
Yeah, the guy was...
I think it was a messenger of some sort, or something of the sort. Yeah. I don't think it was just a random dude. I don't know that for a fact. I can't remember that. Okay, where are we at? 18. Thank you, Nicole. And when they saw him far off, even before he came near unto them, they conspired against him to slay him. And they said one to another, behold, this dreamer comes. Come now, therefore, and let us slay him and cast him into some pit. And we will say some evil beast has devoured him, and we shall see what will become of his dreams. And Reuben heard it, and he delivered him out of their hands and said, let us not kill him. And Reuben said unto them, shed no blood, but cast him into this pit that is in the wilderness, and lay no hand upon him, that he might rid him out of their hands to deliver him to his father again. And it came to pass, so there's one brother out of all of them.
The oldest.
The oldest, and he's like, oh boy, this isn't going to go down well.
I mean, he probably couldn't do much because there's like 10 of them against him.
Yeah, they're all wild and rowdy. I mean, these guys are wild, wild children.
And these people take on cities by themselves.
Yeah, they're killers. I mean, these guys are literally slaughtering killers. And it came to pass, when Yosef was come unto his brother, that they stripped Yosef out of his coat of many colors that was on him. And I don't think it was just like a, you know, like a grab this thing. I think they probably beat the heck out of him. I would imagine they messed him up. I would yeah, say. I mean, they don't like him.
They would just take the jacket. They probably ripped the jacket off.
Some brotherly unlove here. And they took him and cast him into a pit. And the pit was empty. There was no water in it. And they sat down to eat bread, and they lifted up their eyes and looked, and behold, a company of Yishmaelim came from Gilead with their camels bearing spicery and balm and myrrh, going to carry it down to Mitzrayim. And Yehuda said unto his brother, what profit is it if we slay our brother and conceal his blood? Come, and let us sell him to the Yishmaelim, and let it not our hand be upon him, for he is our brother and our flesh, and his brethren were content. Then there passed by Midian merchantmen, and they drew and lifted up Yosef out of the pit, and sold Yosef to the Yishmaelim for 20 pieces of silver. And they brought Yosef into Mitzrayim. And Reuben returned into the pit, and behold, Yosef was not in the pit, and he rent his clothes. And he returned unto his brethren and said, the child is not, and I, whither shall I go? And they took Yosef's coat, and killed a kid of the goats, and dipped the coat in the blood. And they sent the coat of many colors, and they brought it to their father and said, this have we found, now know now whether it be your son's coat or no. And he knew it and said, it is my son's coat. An evil beast has devoured him. Yosef is without, double rent in pieces. And Yaakov rent his clothes and put sackcloth upon his loins and mourned for his son many days. And all his sons and all his daughters rose up to comfort him. But he refused to be comforted. And he said, for I will go down into Sheol unto my son mourning. Thus his father wept for him. And Midian sold him into Mitzrayim unto Potiphar, an officer of Pharaoh's and captain of the guard. All right, so anyone else have anything extracurricular from the other books?
Yeah, so Reuben actually left. I don't know where he left. He left for quite a while, and then his trip down to Mitzrayim was really cool because he was bawling, basically. I mean, you probably would be if your brother just sold you to slavery.
And you're talking about Joseph
bawling. Joseph, yeah, Joseph was bawling.
Right, not Reuben.
No, Reuben was not bawling. And he ended up where his mother was buried, and his mother talked to him from the grave, saying, it's all right, Yah has a plan for you, be strong, it's going to be all right.
Yeah, the Ishmaelite guys, they beat the snot out of him.
Yeah.
And so they there's like the accounts of him were getting beat up and crying a lot, and just, you know, he was the weaker of the dudes, but
I'm Potiphar takes really good care of him, so.
Well, yes.
For a while.
Oh, you're breaking your what is that?
Spoilers.
Spoilers. Spoiler alert. Is that the one where you can't take any of your friends to the movies with you?
Yeah.
Okay, 38. We'll end on 38, so we'll go from here. We are officially in this 20 minutes. And it came to pass at that time that Yehuda went down from his brother and turned into a certain Adullami. And so Adullami. It's a native of Adullam.
Okay.
Okay, whose name was... I don't want to slaughter.
Kira?
Yeah, it's Hora.
Kira.
And Yehuda saw there a daughter of a certain Kenani, whose name was Shurak. And he took her and went in unto her. And she conceived and bore a son, and he called his name Er. And she conceived again and bore a son, and she called his name Onan. And she conceived and bore a son, and called his name Shelach. And he was at Keziv when she bore him. Now this is, you know, we just went through five verses, and that's got to be, at least nine months right here per kid. Verses, so yeah. We're talking, that was a couple of years and five lines right here. So.
But Salah's a lot younger.
Yeah, Salah's much younger. We'll find out that in a minute.
Right. And Yehuda took a woman for his firstborn, whose name was Tamar. And Yehuda's firstborn, was wicked in the sight of Yehuda, and Yehuda slew him.
Yahuwah.
What did I say?
Yehuda.
Yeah. Yehuah slew him. Thanks, Eli. And Yehuda said unto Onan, go in unto your brother's woman and marry her and raise up seed to your brother. Okay. Is this a command?
No. We learn about that later, but no, he just commanded his son to do something.
Why is he commanding his son to do this?
Because I feel like they had a command before. Like, I feel like they had a Torah before, and when they went down to Mitzrayim, they lost that Torah, so they had to reinstate it. So it's like when Yeshua came back, they had like a third renewal of this.
Well, covenant. When Moshe comes, what is the law if you have a woman and your brother dies?
If your brother who is married dies and does not have any children, then you must raise up an heir for your brother.
Right, and so that, I guess we won't put this in as a command now, but I mean, this is a command he's...
We put like a reference to, like references where it happened in the Bible or something.
Maybe. Yeah, because the command will be coming up at some point, and so wherever this command is where it is. So, 10, is that where we're at?
You said go in, yes.
Okay.
No,
and,
9.
9, and Onan knew that the seed should not be his, and it came to pass when he went in unto his brother's woman that he spilled it on the ground. Lest he should give seed to his brother. Gentlemen. And the thing which he did displeased Yahuwah, wherefore he slew him also.
Next.
I got nothing, okay. Man.
Well, he basically was like, I don't know, like an evil dude. Like, he didn't want to, like, raise up, honor his death of his brother or something.
Why wouldn't you want to do this? Okay, so, I mean, here's the command. Is if you guys all got married and one of you died, childless. Would you raise up your? Would you follow?
I mean, it's a command to. If you were married as well, it'd be
weird. How would you run that by your wife?
I don't. I have no idea.
See, that's the thing. I don't
you
know
really how. Must like your in laws, right? You must.
Okay, like if not, if anything okay. else, like in today's day, if they were not able to marry, if something happened, I would just ask, like, please take care of my wife. If I was dying or something. Like, I don't know how you would like do it in today's society.
What do you mean, how to do it in today's society? So, would you follow Yah's commandment and take your brother's wife in?
And the thing is, the parents, everyone in this little area would have to be Torah keepers. They have to understand this. If not, it'd be completely wild.
Yeah, and I mean, I guess necessarily you wouldn't have to, like, I mean, you're supposed to marry her. You're supposed to, like, have multiple wives, and so that would...
Multiple wives, not
maybe one of us. Maybe one of us gets married, and the other one doesn't get married for like a solid 5 to 8 years, just in case something happens. Just in case.
Well, you guys better choose. This is going nowhere. I shouldn't even go. All right, so I was gonna say, man, make sure it's a woman you both like for sure. This is absolutely terrible.
All right.
Okay, so the bottom line is: are you guys going to take in? Yes.
I have to say yes.
Okay.
Obedience to the Torah. Yeah.
Okay.
Hopefully you have kids, you better.
Well, so when you guys do find a wife, you're going to have to explain this stuff to her.
Hey. So look, if he dies, I got to take her as well. Can we somehow settle on this?
This is never going to go well, ever. I can just tell you this. Okay. I don't know how it goes down. All right. Where are we at?
10.
10. And the thing which he did displeased Yahuwah, wherefore he slew him also. So we have two kids just got smoted.
Dead.
Then said Yahuwah to Tamar, his daughter-in-law, remain a widow at your father's house till Shelach, my son be grown. For he said, lest perchance he die also as his brethren did. And Tamar went and dwelt in her father's house. Okay, so we have a woman that is basically, she's keeping, where? Why did she go back to her father's house? I mean, this is...
Because according to the Torah, which obviously they had a Torah before, if a widow did not have any relatives or someone to take, she would return to his father's house until she either marry again or just live in the priestly house where she would eat the priestly food.
Right, okay.
If she did not have a child, all right.
Yes, and Tamar went and dwelled in her father's house, and in process, 12, and in process of time, the daughter of Shuach, Yahuda's woman died, and Yahuda was comforted, and went up unto his sheep bearers to Timnath, and he and his friend Kira, and Adullami, and it was told Tamar, saying, behold, your father-in-law goes up to Timnath to shear his sheep. And this is where things get jiggy. And she put her widow's garment off from her and covered her with a veil and wrapped herself and sat in an open place, which is, by the way, to Timnah. For she saw that Shelach was grown, and she was not given unto him to be his woman. When Yahuwah saw her, he thought her to be a harlot because she had covered her face. So this is very interesting. Is this guy just about to break Torah?
This guy's about to do some wickedness.
His wife's dead, though.
This is some wickedness. Who's this all the way around? He's not keeping his promises. He's not doing... Okay.
All right, hold on. Let's read it.
We'll break this down in a moment.
All right, so when Yahuwah saw her, verse 15, he thought her to be a harlot because she had covered her face, and he turned unto her by the way and said, Go to, I pray you, let me come in unto you, for he knew not that she was his daughter-in-law. And she said, what will you give me that you may come in unto me? And he said, I will send you a kid from the flock. And she said, will you give me a pledge till you send it? And he said, what pledge shall I give you? And she said, your signet and your bracelets and your staff that is in your hand. No problem. He just gave it up. And he gave it to her and came in unto her, and she conceived by him. And she arose and went away and laid by her veil from her and put on the garments of her widowhood. Very interesting. Okay, verse 20. And Yahuwah sent the kid by the hand of his friend, the Adullami, to receive his pledge from the woman's hand, but he found her not. Then he asked the men of that place, saying, where is the harlot that was openly by the wayside? And they said, there was no harlot in this place. And he returned to El Yahuda and said, I cannot find her. And also the men of the place said, there was no harlot in this place. And Yahuda said, Let her take it to her, lest we be shamed. Behold, I sent this kid, and you have not found her. And it came to pass about 3 months after that it was told Yahuwah, saying, Tamar, your daughter-in-law, has played the harlot. And also, behold, she is with child by whoredom. And Yahuwah said, bring her forth and let her be burnt. When she was brought forth, she sent to her father-in-law, saying, by the man who these are am I with child. And she said, discern, I pray you, whose are these, the signet and bracelets and staff? And Yahuwah acknowledged them and said, she has been more righteous than I, because that I gave her not to Shelach my son, and he knew her again no more. And it came to pass in the time of her travail that, behold, twins were in her womb. And it came to pass when she travailed that the one put out his hand, and the midwife took and bound upon his hand a scarlet thread, saying, this came out first. And it came to pass that he drew back his hand, that, behold, his brother came out, and she said, how have you broken forth? This breach be upon you. Therefore his name was called Peretz. And afterward came out his brother that had the scarlet thread upon his hand, and his name called Zerek.
And this is the line of Yeshua, the Messiah.
This is the line of the Messiah. So it didn't actually come from, I mean, it could have, I guess it could have been worse, but this is, it's not actually like it is inter-family, but it's not like a real daughter-in-law. It is a daughter-in-law, but it's not a daughter. Right, it could be far worse. There could be like serious incest or something here, because yes, our Messiah came from this line right here, and so this, and there's also some more stuff in the future. You know, our Messiah came from Ruth, and she was a Moabite. She wasn't even a Yahoo part of the Israelite or anything like that. You know, she was from a different people that worshiped a different way, and she decided that she was going to go the way of Yah. So that is it. That concludes everything. I don't think we have any commandments. Anybody?
No, I got nothing.
Nothing. All right, so there's another three chapters that we blew out today, and I guess that's that. Anyone have anything?
Read your Bibles.
Have a good evening. Spend some time with your family in the Word if you guys have time.
Yeah, spend some time with
even
your family.
Even if you don't have time, just like open the Word like on work during lunch break, open your Bible. If you can get a Bible app on your phone, we recommend like the Blue Letter Bible if you can't afford the Sefer or something of that degree. It is great to have those on the Blue Letter Bible. You can get multiple translations and verify, see the differences. But just try and get into the Word. Try and begin
use a,
to
use
walk.
A version that works for you that you can read. And I people will slaughter it, but I like the NIV because it's really easy to read. It's riddled with translation errors, but so is the King, and so is every other version. They just can't get everything 100% right, so we need multiple versions of different translations to understand exactly what it is saying so we don't get off track. All right, so that is it. That is the Law, Statutes, and Commands. We are to the end of this today, and we hope you guys are good.
Shalom.
Shalom.
All right, bye, everyone.